gentlemen. Hope you are motivated. Hour two of Flow of Wisdom Radio, picking up where we left off on last week's broadcast, more so on this invasive technology here, and it's just continuing to grow and invade our lives at a rate that's just... It's crazy when you start to think about it. You know, some of the things that I mentioned in the last hour, I hope that you guys put it all into perspective. That in the very near future, we are going to be one with technology. Now, some may say, well, Sean, we're already one with technology. People can't go anywhere without their cell phones. Yes, I understand that, but I'm talking about integrated Neuralink implants, microchips, RFID chips. And it's going to be made so convenient that most would see that it would be a necessity. And the marketing, the propaganda campaign behind it is to get you to believe that this is something that you need. This is something that's necessary. And there it is. You know, this stuff is so powerful. And again, on a psychological level, as I've always mentioned, it's very, very powerful. Remember that I just mentioned in the past hour, the last hour of the show, how smart dust could be used to monitor human thought. How invasive is that? Let alone the technology already monitoring what we say with the microphones. It's one thing to be monitored via video. But what if it's monitoring your thoughts? What if it's monitoring your thoughts? As I mentioned, you know, this study of the woman being able to, who was paralyzed, she had lost use of her arms and legs. She was able to control a robotic arm using her brain waves. And this was several years ago. So what's to say what the future is going to look like? You know, when I broke down the whole 2045 initiative, Dmitry Itzkov, it's inevitable. They're talking about uploading human consciousness into an avatar. Uploading your consciousness into a machine and being able to control that machine with your thoughts. This is crazy. So one of the researchers in this article in Forbes on how smart dust could be used to monitor human thought, it says the researcher's goal is to build an implantable system that is ultra miniature, extremely compliant, and scalable to be viable for a lifetime for brain-machine interfaces. Brain-machine interfaces. This is how we're going to be integrated with machines. When you look up companies like Kindred AI, it's a startup in Canada. Jordy Rose, he's the man behind it. Jordy Rose is the one that started D-Wave, the quantum computer. He backed out from that and started Kindred AI. And their objective is to work, create these robots to work hand in hand with humans. Him and his partner, humans and AIs working together to control robots are always better than either by themselves, he says. This is the world that we live in, ladies and gentlemen. This is the future of the world that we're going to be living in. Teaching computers to learn on their own is the core aim of AI research, it says. The world's largest tech companies, including Facebook, Google, and China's Baidu, are all racing to develop the best techniques. Breakthroughs in speech and image recognition, but machines still struggle to handle basic physical tasks such as grasping objects. Improving robots' physical dexterity is the first problem Kindred AI is trying to tackle. We're talking about the pure integration of technology and humans. And what is the sacrifice? What is it that we have to give up in order to gain? Think about it. 877-300-7645. Chime in on the conversation. Let's go to Toronto. Got Marcus in Toronto. Wants to talk about satellite surveillance. Marcus, welcome to Flow of Wisdom.
Hi, Sean. Sorry about that. I was thinking about something else, and then the person cut in and said, what would you like to talk about? And that was in my mind.
Sure. What's up?
Actually, what I wanted to say was the poor lady who is getting targeted. I can basically answer your post on YouTube, and if she can find it for this show, I can help her out with stuff, since you don't like giving me out my email.
No, go ahead, give it out, man. Go ahead, give it out.
It's partypoet2012@gmail.com, and if she wants to write me, I can basically tell her how her life can improve. Because they cannot read your mind, but they have games that basically make you think that they can to propagate this stuff on social media. Because the catch is that they'll actually make the implants really expensive so that people actually have to pay a lot of money. And then you'll get a huge raise at work if you come in with an implant for whatever you do, and that's how they'll get people to want implants in their head. They always want to basically make it so that people are willing to pay a lot of money for something that serves them absolutely no purpose whatsoever. Like, I don't know if you've ever looked into the fact that everything you buy comes with a user manual. No owner's manual. You don't own anything you buy. You get to be a user for something that you paid a lot of money for, because the owners basically want to control the way everything goes. Six companies own all the media in the entire world, so it's not hard for them to get going in one direction. And as far as So they've been socially engineering this entire planet to go in the direction that I just keep saying. The whole reason for the huge lie is that everybody, when you say, which way do you want to go when you die? And everybody keeps saying, you should point up. And I keep telling people that every single race, creed, color, religion has people that died and came back, and they all ran into loved ones. But what are your loved ones doing, sort of like being the ushers or the welcome wagon for after you die? When you're supposed to die, you get judged. So you're not in the welcome wagon section. Mm-hmm. And all those people are saying, go up. And I keep saying, what if those people are really messing you up, because headed towards the light, and the light bearer is all the devil himself. Quite openly stated, he is the guy who is in charge of the light, so heading towards the light may be a huge mistake. And everybody keeps thinking that it's all on the moon. Something happened on the moon, because the moon came after the planet Earth formed. This much everybody's willing to agree upon. It's just how it formed, people are sort of
speaking of the moon. That. My question is to NASA: why haven't they gone back? If we landed on the moon, how come we've never gone back? But we're doing all of these expeditions in Mars, and Pluto, and Saturn, and all of these other stuff. Why have we not gone back to the moon? Can you answer that?
Why isn't there a McDonald's up there by now?
Oh,
first
man.
Thing to ever show up.
McDonald's, right?
But you know what's really funny is if the moon is really a quarter of a million miles away, the size that it is, you know, the way we see it, as bright as we see it, according to the laws of illumination, the moon would have to be five times brighter than a welder's torch.
Gotcha. All right, Marcus, yeah. Thanks for the call, man. Got to move on. Appreciate it. Yep, 877-300-7645. That was Marcus in Toronto. He said, why isn't there a McDonald's up there? Right. Well, what's going on up there in the moon? Elon Musk says that we can do it within 10 years or less than 10 years or 5 years or something like that. Why have we not been back? Interesting question. So look, we're coming up on a break here. I have a book here that it's called Predictive Analytics, The Power to Predict Who Will Click, Buy, Lie, or Die, Eric Siegel. And I want to share an excerpt out of that, you know, but the influence is extremely powerful as it pertains to media and especially social media. But that's what it talks about, predicting influence and all of the data and information that we voluntarily provide to these social media companies, and able to take that information, use it against us, and be able to predict our behavior. You know, so much so that there's a voodoo doll like avatar of us on the hard drive servers of Google and Facebook. We'll be back. It's Floor of Wisdom. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. Sean Anthony broadcasts live every Sunday, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. The website is flowofwisdom.com. Call in, be a part of the show, join the conversation as others have, 877-300-7645. And, you know, you talk about the invasiveness of this technology. We talk about how powerful the control, the psychological programming in social media is extremely sophisticated. And so much so that some of these tech insiders talk about how people's minds can be hijacked. They fear a smartphone dystopia. The Guardian put out an extensive piece a couple of years ago on this subject. They believe that these tech companies never deliberately set out to make their products addictive. They were responding to the incentives of an advertising economy, experimenting with techniques that might capture people's attention, even stumbling across highly effective design by accident. See, we live in a capitalistic society. Companies want to figure out how can we make money off of the people. So they put together focus group think tanks and study human behavior, psychology, and they put up these different scenarios to see what's going to prompt people to respond. And that's all it is. How will you respond to an image, a picture, a statement, etc.? And see, now, I wouldn't say that these think tanks and focus groups aren't needed, but the level of sophistication has excelled at such a rate because now it's integrated into technology. They're able to look at the algorithms. They're able to look at the data. Do you remember several years ago, their Facebook caught some backlash off of a test that they were doing without users knowing that they were being tested on? And what they were doing is they were controlling your news feed to see how people responded emotionally. And they would change certain words, whether it be positive words or negative words, and watching how people would respond. You would respond. They were noticing you would respond differently based off of how they altered your news feed. When I log on to Facebook and what comes up in my news feed, it's going to be a different experience for you. Your news feed, your experience on Facebook is going to be totally different from mine. That's why you'll see certain people, some of your friends on Facebook will, you know, making certain comments or certain posts, you know, when they're on their soapbox. You know, we've all gotten on our soapbox, right? Certain people will get on their soapbox and start venting about certain things on what they see on others posting. That's because their experience, their news feed is tailored to them based on their behavior. It's crazy. I don't have any kind of, I don't have notifications. I don't have Facebook Messenger. And trust me, they keep sending me notifications, you know, not notifications. When I do log on to it from a computer, it's always asking me, download Messenger. I don't want no extra access. I have 5,000 friends on Facebook on one, and then I have 2,800, excuse me, a little over 2,800 people that like my Flow of Wisdom page. And that's primarily what I use Facebook for, is to promote and share information as it pertains to Flow of Wisdom. I'm not even that active on my personal account anymore. Just because I'm, you know, I just, the further and further I get into this research and start understanding this stuff, the more reluctant I am on being as active on it as I was in the past. We'll take your calls right after this on Flow of Wisdom Radio. Oh, yeah, let's dive a little deeper. Let's dive deeper into this Amazon. Y'all, welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. Sean Anthony here. Amazon says it can detect fear on your face. I brought this article up last week, but we're going to go into this a little deeper, go into it a little bit more. It says, even as Amazon, oh yeah, by the way, this is on Wired, wired.com. Amazon, Google, and Microsoft charge ahead with algorithms that intuit feelings. Psychologists warn that trying to read emotions from facial expressions is fundamentally misguided. UC Berkeley researchers found that for a person to accurately read someone else's emotions in a video requires paying attention to not just their face, but also their body language and surroundings. Software offered by tech companies generally analyzes each face in isolation. As with facial recognition, easier access to emotion recognition algorithms seem to be causing the technology to spread more widely, including into law enforcement. In July, Oxygen Forensics, which sells software to the FBI and others use to extract data from smartphones. And this lines up with Jami, who called in the last hour of the show. So anyway, Oxygen Forensics, they sell the software to FBI and others so that these companies, these alphabet organizations can extract data from smartphones. They added facial recognition and emotion detection to its product. See, this emotion detection is now being added along with facial recognition. Remember the example I keep giving on that one movie in Elysium starring Matt Damon, where he's in that facility going back and forth, communicating with a robot, and the robot detects that he's getting upset. And he's like, no, I'm not getting upset. And the thing is just reading all these, the data, the algorithms, his heart rate, his eyes dilating, his pupils dilating. His breathing pattern has changed. His blood pressure is rising. This robot is able to collect all of this data and say, look, according to this information, I'm able to determine whether you're getting angry or not. Anyway, it says at least one big tech company appears to have decided that emotion recognition isn't worth the effort. IBM, of course, they compete with Amazon, Microsoft, and cloud computing and facial recognition, but does not offer emotion detection. A spokesperson from IBM said the company does not plan to offer such a service. The article also talks about Google, how it does not offer facial recognition. A decision, it says, resulted from an internal ethical review, raising concerns that the technology could be used to infringe on what? Privacy. You don't say. You don't say. So Google says its emotion detection features pass through the same review process that the nixed facial recognition. The company has also decided that it's okay to apply the technology to personal photos of its users. Searching for happiness, surprise, or anger in Google's Photos app will surface images with appropriate facial expressions. It will also look for fear. Now, one side of the coin, some may say, well, man, that's pretty cool. But then when you start to really think about, like, what could they possibly be doing with this information? What could they possibly do with technology that can detect our emotions? If they have, this is just me thinking out loud. If there is technology that can detect my emotions, then surely there must be technology that can control or influence my emotions. That goes back to the social engineering, the psychology behind it. This stuff is so powerful. That's why we gotta be careful again on what bandwagon or hashtag or pro this or anti that we hop on social media. A lot of these online campaigns have been, I don't believe that. And hear me out now. This is not to say that all of the campaigns are like this, but I think a lot of them are manufactured. They're manufactured and created to rile up people, to get people riled up and to follow a certain narrative. I just really believe it. There's an interesting documentary on Netflix talking about the whole debacle with Cambridge Analytica and Facebook. Very interesting. Very interesting. I strongly advise you guys, if you like the information that I talk about on Flow of Wisdom, you would definitely enjoy that documentary on Netflix. Because it even talks about what I just mentioned, how some of the online campaigns or narratives or hashtags were created during the presidential campaign. This stuff is on a whole nother level. You can easily go onto your personal Twitter account or Facebook account and get one or two or three emotions roused up inside. I guarantee it. That's why you got to have some sort of control, set some parameters around yourself so that you can not allow that to control your emotions. controlling your emotions without the technology, that's a task in itself. Imagine trying to control your emotions just within your home, with your relatives, with your loved one. Then you'd pick up this sophisticated technological device called a smartphone that has been able to figure out predictive analytics and be able to guide you into the way that it wants you to think. It's extremely powerful. Let's go to the phones. 877-300-7645. Leroy in Atlanta wants to talk about the influence of social media. What's up, Leroy? Welcome to Flow of Wisdom.
Wow. This stuff can be really confusing if you're not paying attention, huh?
Absolutely.
Man, last night I watched the Chappelle new stand-up on Netflix. Have you seen it, Sticks and Stone?
Yes.
Boy, he's turning over the apple cart.
To say the least, I mean, right?
Yeah, and if you go at him, you're only exposing yourself. You're only helping him to expose you more.
What do you mean?
And the things he was saying about, which is pretty much in line with what you're talking about as far as the influence of social media and how people can be manipulated.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't go into detail as far as I call them the idiots that be instead of the powers that be.
Okay.
He didn't go into detail on that end. That's where your focus is. But for the conniving is, it's incredible. I mean, we have all these mass shootings, which they've been going on in the past, but it's a systematic effort to gain control over the spirit. And their gateway is the mind and the heart. That through those very emotions that they claim to now be able to track.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the proverb says, guard your heart. Guard your heart, because the issues flow out of it. And that mind, too. Those are two things that needs to be guarded at all times. And how do you get to the heart? When you start looking at the Proverbs, is what you hear is what you see. And you manifest those things by what you speak. So trying to control your tongue and controlling your emotions gets you to speak out on certain things. Boom, they got you. They got you. It's powerful, man. But yeah, that Dave Chappelle, I love comedians. You know, a lot of people don't know, Leroy, at the beginning of my radio career, early stages of my radio career, I was also in the comedy arena. Now, I wasn't no stand-up, but I worked with a comedian who owned a comedy stop. I would pass out flyers for him, and plus I would also work the music for the comedians that would come in his comedy club. You know, when comedians would get introduced, music comes on. I did all of that, and I was like 16, 17 years old, but I studied comedians. I studied them, man. I was a student of the game of radio and comedy. So I have a special thing with comedians, man, you know, and how they're able to control the crowd and take things that could be, you know, real life situations and make it funny. But anyway, go ahead.
Great comedians take the controversial and they make it funny.
Absolutely.
But now they're being censored to, they can't even be funny.
Yeah.
You have to explain.
Hold on, Leroy. Hold on. I got to take a quick break. Hold that thought, man. Comedians can't even be funny right now. Hold on. We'll get Leroy to come back after this commercial break. Don't go anywhere, y'all. This is Flow of Wisdom. Oh. Yeah. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom Radio. I am your host, Sean Anthony. 877-300-7645. We got Leroy in Atlanta on the line. Leroy, wait a minute. Before I get to Leroy, hang on tight, Leroy. There's an article I meant to bring up earlier in this hour. It was sent to me last week from Bruce out in Texas, who listens to the show. In Zero Hedge, check this out, Leroy. New lip reading CCTV will have people cupping hands over their mouths in the public. Why? Because in cahoots with this facial recognition technology, new lip reading technology will have people putting their hands over their mouths just to hold a conversation in the street, according to the government's surveillance watchdog, Tony Porter. This is an article in Zero Hedge. I didn't get a chance to dive into it, but I wanted to put that out there. But yeah, this stuff is becoming extremely invasive, man. Imagine a lip reading technology as you're out in the public.
I guess the NBA players already knew this was out there. That's why LeBron James and everybody else, when they're on the court, they, hey, what you doing tonight? I don't know right. What you doing tonight.
Yep, exactly. But you were talking about the comedians, right? They can't be funny. Why? Because of the political correctness now, the society that we live in today?
Oh, absolutely. If you say one wrong thing, whether it was today or 50 years ago, they're going to drag it out and roast you for it. Mm-hmm. I was listening to the show last week, and in conjunction with some of the things that were said earlier in this show. So when it comes to the moon, India has announced that they're going to the far side of the moon.
Right.
Yeah, it's supposed to take them 47 days to get there. Hmm. And now reading this information, I felt led to look up, you know, well, how long did it take the Apollo mission to go to the moon and come back?
Right.
8 days.
How about that?
It took 8 days then, and that's taking 47 days to go to the far side of the moon. Then I started looking at the moon and the rotation. The rotation, it barely turns.
Mm. Something ain't adding up with the moon, man. I'm telling you.
No. And then, one of the byproducts from dropping the bomb over there in Japan, they found out was that it disrupts electricity, right? Mm-hmm. So now you got EMPs. And that's the result of the radiation, if I'm not mistaken. Well, around the Earth, there's supposed to be these bands built that are radiation built. Mm-hmm. So how do you control a car, remote control Jeep, or whatever it is they got, they say is roving around Mars, when you send in this information through radiation belt?
Stuff don't add up. When they talk that space talk, you know, Trump just announced something too. There, you know, I think maybe next week I'll do a show on space and we'll just talk about space, because, you know, as much, I'm fascinated by it, Leroy, to be honest with you, but there's certain things, just like you're pointing out, that just don't add up. Like, which is it? You know, you say the Apollo mission took 8 days, but yet India mentioned that they're going to be going to the far side of the moon. And you said the report, I mean, I'm going off of what you're saying. You said it 47 days, like something does not. And then why has it taken so long for us to go back to the moon?
Especially when they tell you what the smartphone you have now has more computing power than Apollo 13. For real? And then there's this. I mean, I have to see the footage. I'm not sure. But we do know that when what we are shown, let me put it like that, when mm-hmm. people come down from the space station, they can't even walk. Mm-hmm. I'd really like to know if Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong, did they just walk off the Apollo 1 stage and get back down here?
I don't know. I know Bart Sobrell got punched by Buzz Aldrin. I had him on the show talking about, you know, the moon landing was fake. But anyway, Leroy, we ran out of time, man. We got to wrap this one up, man. Always good to hear from you. Thanks for the call.
Hey, y'all, keep praying.
All right, man, we'll do. Yo, I hope and pray you guys have a great week. Remember to live life, get wisdom, and let it flow. I'm Sean Anthony. This is Flow of Wisdom. Peace. Wisdom on the mic with Sean Anthony. Get it motivated. Get it motivated.